Good morning, Bioneers. I am speaking to you today from the occupied and unceded Ohlone territory of Huchin in what is now called Oakland, California. I'm grateful to my ancestors for all their love that brought me here today to be able to share these ideas with you, and to the ancestors of this land who have offered me a safe home to raise my children far from Punjab, where my family comes from, and who inform how I've been learning and growing in this place I call home. I also want to acknowledge my elders whose teaching continue to shape my own work and understanding. A diagnosis is a story told out of joint that helps us identify the cause of disease or suffering with the goal of alleviating it. For healing, in order to get at the right course of action, one has to start with the correct diagnosis. The wrong diagnosis ultimately delays the proper treatment. Recently, I was taking care of a Black woman in her 50s hospitalized at UCSF. She had a history of sickle cell disease and came to the ER with shoulder pain. When she was admitted, the doctors who evaluated her saw her x-rays, which showed no fracture or dislocation, and her blood counts, which indicated anemia. And they concluded that she was having a sickle cell pain crisis. But this woman hadn't had a sickle cell pain crisis in well over a decade. By the time I met her, she was 10 days into her hospitalization, and she had been on IV fluids and IV opiates with no change in her shoulder pain. I sat down with her and listened to her story. She told me her pain woke her up from sleep. With a brief exam and an MRI to confirm my suspicion, I diagnosed a full thickness rotator cuff tear. She got anti-inflammatory medicine, physical therapy, and a surgical consultation. With the correct diagnosis, she was on her way to healing. Today, the world heaves from systems level failures, evidenced by the intersecting crises of pandemic and climate catastrophe. Public health experts and governments fail to properly address the problems we face, because their solutions do not address the problem at the level of the system. While vaccination and masking are helpful to mitigate the harms of COVID, if we look at how the virus spreads through spaces of incarceration, where humans are warehoused in nursing homes or prisons, or where people are forced into exposure at work in places like meatpacking facilities, it becomes clear that fugitivity from a system that creates the incarceration must play a role in our response. To understand why our bodies and our planet are suffering in the ways that they are, we need the correct diagnosis. And for that, we must extend our story back in time to 600 years ago, when narratives were told that opened the door to systems of domination that made land theft and resource extraction possible on a global scale. Colonial capitalist cosmology is driving damage around the globe in ways that are making a healthy life for humans impossible. And that damage will continue until the cosmology and the systems it imagines into reality are abolished and replaced with ones that recognize our interconnectedness and ones that center care. The care revolution must be grounded in a clear understanding of who we are, how we got here, and how we can be on this planet together in ways that generate health. Bodies of people living in societies organized through colonial capitalist cosmology are bodies racked by inflammatory disease. Inflammation underlies all the leading causes of death in modern industrialized societies. These diseases, such as cardiovascular disease, cancer, diabetes, autoimmune disease, are rare in traditional and indigenous communities living with intact cosmologies that weave them into the web of life that supports them. The hallmark of colonial capitalist cosmology is one of separation, of people from one another, of people from the earth and her systems, and of people from other living entities upon which our own health depends. This separation serves an important function for those who stand to benefit from this system. It becomes easier to extract resources, exploit labor, and concentrate wealth into fewer hands. And through this separation, there is much damage. The body's response to damage or the threat of damage is inflammation. The inflammatory response is the body's ancient healing mechanism to restore its optimal functioning condition in the face of damage. In the acute setting, as in with a paper cut, the inflammatory response heals and then turns off. But when the damage keeps coming, the inflammatory response runs unabated. This healing response then becomes one itself that does more harm. When it comes to chronic inflammatory disease, twin studies show that the environment is more impactful than our genetics. That includes not only what is in our local environment, but also in our histories and the way lines of power have been drawn. The sum of our lifetime exposures is called the exposome. It actually extends before our lifetimes through our ancestral lineages. Intergenerational trauma leaves its traces in our bodies by way of inflammatory disease. This is important to understand because colonial medicine frames chronic inflammatory disease as the outcome of poor lifestyle choices. We are told to improve our diet and get more exercise. Peddlers of microbiome pills are there to capitalize. And while these things can help, they are not the ultimate source of our healing. Focusing on individual choices is a form of medical gaslighting when the actual driver of pathology is in the world that has been constructed around our bodies. For most people on planet Earth, a toxic exposome is not a matter of choice. It is the outcome of colonial capitalist architecture. In this understanding, disease is situated in the spaces around the body, in the exposome, and in the cumulative history of relationships lived through our bodies and minds. When we look at this process on a cellular level, we can see how these exposures leave their marks in the body, in our replicating somatic cells. Usually, these replicating cells will divide and live until they reach senescence or cellular aging, when they go metabolically quiet. But cells can age prematurely as a consequence of damage. A toxic exposome accelerates this phenomenon, driving the premature aging of cells through the accumulation of damage over time. Premature aging through damage forces a cell into cell cycle arrest and a radical transformation in which that aging cell acquires what's called the senescence-associated secretory phenotype, or SASP. In summary, instead of being metabolically quiet in its old age, these cells become factories pumping out molecular messengers that drive inflammation throughout the body. These SASP cells are the link to inflammaging, the presence of chronic inflammatory disease as people get older in societies organized through damaging structures. From liver fibrosis to neurodegenerative disease, these cells are driving fire in our bodies. Inflammation is not just the animal's way of responding to damage in attempt to restore optimal working conditions. It's also what we see today in the planet's body, with heat or swelling, catastrophic wildfires, uninhabitable temperatures, and flooding. From the tiniest invisible thing to the largest invisible thing, from the microscopic to the macroeconomic, systems impacted by damage are systems that are inflamed. The same mindset that is hurting our bodies is setting our world on fire. The deep trouble we are in requires deep medicine, nothing less than a transformation of our world and the way it is organized will be sufficient to bring about the cooling we need. And that transformation must be led by the correct diagnosis. Like deep ecology recognizes the wisdom of ecologies beyond, above and beyond their capacity to serve humans, deep medicine moves individuals from the center of our understanding of health and places the systems to which we belong in focus. Individuals can only be healthy when the systems around them are healthy. Deep medicine understands that health is an emergent phenomenon when systems are interacting in mutually beneficial ways without incurring damage. We cannot have health when we leave some people or some other beings out of the circle of our concern. If disease is caused by a toxic exposome, health becomes possible when the exposome is structured through systems of care. The largest living organism on Earth appears to be a forest of individual aspen trees. In fact, it is one organism called Pando. The whole should never be confused as the sum of its atomized parts. It is larger and a more complex network of being. Colonial capitalism has exploited the world, her people, and resources. Deep medicine puts the personhood back in the beings that capitalism would have us see as inanimate, the mountains, the rivers, the very body of the earth, of which we are a part, not apart from. To find ourselves back in the web of life and to reawaken all of our relationships and responsibilities to each other, other humans, and other more than humans, this is the foundational starting place of deep medicine. Deep medicine requires that we abandon the culture of individualism and the damage of domination, opting for care that is brought about through nurturing networks, embracing collective experience and knowledge. These networks are already more resilient to climate shocks and volatility, as evidenced in peasant farming movements and agroecological movements throughout the world. Deep medicine eschews self-aggrandizing thought leaders and billionaire philanthropists for the wisdom held by the lived experience of communities, groups of people who are already working autonomously around the world to advance a culture of care. It understands that the logic and system of capitalism cannot be used to heal the wounds that are created through capitalism. It must be abolished as other toxic systems before it. It is time for radically new concepts of healing. This is the work that we are doing with the Deep Medicine Circle, a woman of color-led, worker-directed organization committed to healing the wounds of colonialism through food, medicine, story, learning, and restoration. We are building culture between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people to reassert their sovereignty and their homelands while weaving together multiple systems of knowing that teach us how to care for the earth and for each other. Here on a farm in Ramaytush Ohlone territory, just a few steps away from where Portola landed and started his genocidal march across the San Francisco Peninsula, we are demonstrating what that looks like in practice. One of our principal areas of work is what we call farming as medicine. As with every modern institution, today's food system is based in colonial capitalist cosmology. The land has been stolen, the indigenous people rendered invisible in their own homelands, the labor exploited, and the soil, water, and air are damaged through extractive processes that enrich few people and leave the rest of the system in poor health. Farming as medicine reverses that order. Land is rematriated, asserting indigenous women's authority over community well-being. Farmers are recast as ecological stewards and health workers, growing food and tending soil under indigenous leadership to heal the earth and heal the people. The food we grow is liberated from the market mentality to be what food has always been before colonialism, medicine. If we want to end world hunger, we have to stop playing by the rules that create hunger in the first place. The care revolution requires that we accurately diagnose why we are here today with our bodies and planet inflamed, so that we may move forward with the correct solutions and not delay the urgent need for healing. While policy is critical to stop the damage, much of the healing work is already happening all around the world in communities that reject the logic of capitalism and create economies of care. With the correct diagnosis, the correct path ahead becomes clear. It is not a softer, fuzzier version of colonialism and capitalism. It is committing to the fire that which must burn so that a world of care can come forward. Thank you.